Hey there, YouTubers. I am now making an air dryer for my air compressor, and I'll be making a manifold out of copper. You can see here in the sketch, we've got our compressor over here to a ball valve going through the regulator into a T, and we've got the snake of copper going up and down with ball valves at the bottom to drain the water. That will go out into one of two designs I'm trying to think about here. This design, shout out to Hannah's Bug. She had this design on her desiccant dryer. I'm also contemplating doing a slightly different version where the air just flows one direction through rather than coming through a center pipe and going through the desiccant on the way out. So we'll see how that goes. That's going to be part two. Today I'm just going to be going over how to create the copper side. I will have parts listed and I will list that in the description. So don't forget to like and share. You can do that right down here and subscribe, and hopefully I'll get part two up soon and I'll put a link right up there. So watch, and hopefully this all work out. Get some dry air for keeping the tools in good condition, and once we eventually get to paint on the 72 satellite, it will help keep fish eyes away. The first step to all this is to get all your parts together. So first thing I'm gonna do is measure these out. They are 10 foot lengths. So we're just going to cut these into 5 foot lengths. And what I started off with is 10 foot, three of these 10 foot half inch copper tubes. I just went down to Home Depot and got them there. Home Depot, they were like 11 bucks a piece. And we'll get three of these cut down to 5 foot lengths. That'll give us 6 5-foot lengths. We're gonna have 5 tubes. So we're going to use 5 of those, and then the last 5 feet will be used for the connectors and then the down tubes that go to the ball joints. Rather than measuring each one of these out, what I'm going to do is just put them all on the floor flat. And then I measured one, and I can go across all three. Some of you might want to be more particular and measure these out individually. I tend to cut some corners like that just to go a little bit faster. You can also get one of these little tools. It'll make your life a little bit easier. This is a pipe cutter. And basically what you do is you put that around the pipe. It's got rollers on one side and a little cutting blade on the other. So once you get it on there, and let me get a little bit close up here. Once you get it on there, you find your line where you're going to cut. You screw this down until it is just a little bit tight, not too tight. You don't want to crank on this because then you'll dent the copper. But once you get a little bit, get it just finger tight, roll it around. After you go around, tighten it up a little bit more. And basically, you just keep doing that until it goes all the way through. If your tool is not tightened perfectly straight, it will basically make kind of like a thread. So rather than going the same direction every time, I like to go back and forth so it will continue to cut and not just make a screw thread all the way down the pipe. And we'll just keep on tightening that. As you can see, it's starting to get a groove there. We've got the little roller wheels on one side, and on the other side there's just that wheel blade. And as you're going around back and forth, it just continues to cut deeper. Might not be a bad idea to throw that in like a little bit of a vise or something to hold it more steady. And once you get through, it will just pop right off like that. Now there will be burrs at the end, and when there's burrs, you're just going to take a little sandpaper or wire wheel and clean those up. Now we've got 2 5-foot lengths. These blanks are a little bit longer than 10 feet, so it's not exact. I'm not looking for exact here. That doesn't really matter at this point, because once we get these cut down to size, we're gonna end up taking these and we'll put, I don't know if you can see, the elbows at the top. There'll be a T down at the bottom with a little extra coming down to the ball valve so you can drain the water out periodically. Alright, so we've got all 6 of our pipes now, and the next step is going to be to cut one of these down for our connecting pieces that are going to connect the verticals. So these are the horizontal pieces going back and forth. I don't know what's going on with the light here. So at the top, if I can point to it here, these connecting pieces in between the elbows and the connecting pieces in between the T's, I'm going to make those 2.5 inches in between. So I need 4 2.5-inch pieces. These you will want to be a little bit more particular on, so the vertical pieces are actually parallel. If you have these different sizes, then your vertical pieces are going to be not parallel, and it might look a little funky. It'll probably still do just as good of a job, but what I'll do here is I'm going to mark the first one 2.5 inches, and then I'm going to cut this one, and then I'll hold that one up to this rod to mark it again for the next one, mark it again for the next one, mark it again for the next one. That way I can be sure that they're all the same size, even if I cut this first one a 16th or whatever, a little bit taller or shorter than the rest of them. Then after that is done, I'm going to take the remainder and divide that by 5. And whatever that number is, it'll give me whatever's left over for these bottom pieces that come down to the ball valve. That way I can drain this once it's filled with water and drain it periodically. So now we're gonna get to cutting again, and we'll grab our little pipe cutter, do this one up close. Again, you just unscrew this so it expands. You put it around, and if I can do this so you can actually see, I've got my line right there. So I'm going to hold it up here while I screw it in. And try to get that nice and level so my blade lands right on that line. So when I'm spinning it, I'll make sure that I have the right size. So I'll go ahead and tighten this down a little bit. Again, you don't want to crank too hard because you can dent this copper because it is a soft metal. And then we'll just spin it around one direction, spin it around the other direction, tighten it a little bit more, go back and forth. And I'm just rotating the entire piece of copper underneath, and once you get through, it'll pop right off. Once it does that, you can just take that, bend it a couple times, and that copper will bend right off. Again, all of these edges that are not perfectly clean, they will need to be sanded and cleaned up, so that way when you're doing your soldering, you get a nice good seal. Now, these burrs here, you can see it's got a burr and it sticks up. That's because this cheapy tool isn't perfectly parallel with this blade, or yeah, perpendicular, I guess. So as you're rolling around, if I went in the same direction around and around and around, it would actually work its way down this pipe. That's why I work back and forth to get that cut, okay? So now that I have that one done, I can line these up. And this is my preferred method when building a lot of things. Rather than measuring the individual pieces, I'll get one cut and then come down here and mark it on the pipe. And if you do that, when you mark it on the pipe, you're going to be marking on the side that you don't want to cut. So with that said, when you line up your blade, you'll want the blade to be on the top side, because you'll want to leave your mark below it, because I just marked, and then that way those pieces will be the exact same size. So let's see how accurate I can be here. I'll go ahead and slide this back on. We'll try to get it lined up here. I'm trying to do this so you can see also, so get it lined up there on the line, okay? And just tighten that down a little bit. Give it a spin in both directions. And now, as we get tighter, you will see that I cut it right on that line on the top side of the line. So it is right where I wanted it to be. Okay? So we can just bend and pop that off. And now if we grab that first piece and we hold them up next to each other, they're both the exact same size. Okay? So let's just follow that process. We need two more of these. We need two elbows at the top, and then we need the two T's at the bottom. We now have our four connecting pieces for the two elbows at the top and the two T's at the bottom. And what we have left over now is this piece. So what we want to do here is we're going to have five vertical tubes. So we need the connecting pieces that are going to go from the bottom of the T down to the ball valves. So what we'll do is measure what we have left. And we have exactly 50 inches, which is nice, because now I know we can just do these in 10-inch increments, because we have five different pieces, and we have 50 inches, so 50 divided by 5 is 10, for all of you that enjoy calculus out there. And we'll go ahead and get these cut. So basically, I'm going to use the same process. I'm going to cut this top section. I'll hold it down here, mark it, hold it, and mark it. Now, these don't really matter if they're the exact same size either, because the drain's coming out the bottom. It doesn't matter. You're just going to be sticking a bucket under there to drain it periodically. So if one's longer than the other, no big deal. Now that everything's cut, just doing a quick dry run here. And as you can see, we're going to go sideways on this. Maybe if we can get it all in the video here. Right down here is where the air will come in. We'll have the compressor, and then it'll have a line that goes through the regulator and filter, and the line will go in here. And the air will travel up and then back down, and then through this T, and then up, and then back down, and then through this T, and then up. And I've got a fitting up there where I can screw in nipple to attach a hose that'll go over to the desiccant side. And then at the bottom here, we've got all these five tubes with ball joints at the end. So that way, as moisture builds up in those tubes, I can drain it out. And then I'll probably put some just PVC flexible pipe or whatever to run all of those into one pipe to have a drain bucket, if I even do that. I don't know. Once this is done, then I will also use some of these little brackets, tube clamps, to attach them to the wall. We've got our solder. You can see here we've got our 3/8 inch nipples. Now, I did spend a little bit more than I had to, because I could have just bought these if I went somewhere else, but at Lowe's today, that this was the only way that I could get these nipple adapters, because they didn't sell them separately. But I could have gone to something like Harbor Freight and picked up some of those. But that'll be a good way to connect to these, which are the reducers, and that will go right here. So there'll be a reducer and a nipple there where the hose will come in, and then there'll be a reducer and a nipple up at the top here where this will connect to go out to the desiccant dryer. Desiccant? I always forget how to say that. Anyways, so we're coming along. That's a quick just dry run to see how it would look and fit together. And then I've got to find out where on my wall I can find some space to put it, hopefully close to my air compressor, because I'd rather have this closer to the air compressor than further away. So we'll get that set up. Maybe I'll stick it back here in the corner. And then once I get the desiccant dryer, I'll have that over there as well. And then I can build a little shield around it, since it's going to be made out of Schedule 40 PVC. Now, for all of you haters out there, when it comes to PVC, keep in mind that I do have a regulator, and that this will be a system with a max PSI of around 90 PSI. It is indoors. It is Houston, so it's not going to be getting sunlight to degrade it in the back. And it's Houston, so it doesn't get freezing cold here. And it should last quite a while, and then I'll have a shield around it as well. So in the event that it does pop and go boom, hopefully if anybody's in here, the shield will take all that shrapnel and won't be sending shit flying everywhere. All right, so the next step is going to be to start working on getting all of these joints soldered. The first thing that I'm going to do, though, is take a wire brush. I did not buy the specific tool to go over the ends of these and clean the ends and clean inside the joints. So what I am going to do is just take a wire brush and hit it with that, maybe some sandpaper on the inside of these. Make sure I get nice and clean metal so that way I can get really good joints and hopefully not have any leaks. I haven't done a whole lot of soldering before on copper, just a little bit. So we'll see how this turns out. I'm sure they're not going to be super pretty, but functional is what I'm after, not form. So we'll see how it goes. Stay tuned. Hey, so I got the first joint done. I did that off camera because, I wasn't sure exactly how it would go. The first thing to do is sand the ends of these and get them nice and cleaned up. You can use a wire brush or one of those tools that spins over it. I just use a little sandpaper. Make sure when you do it that you wipe it completely clean. Take a rag to it so you don't have any dirt or residue or anything in there. And then also you want to make sure that you do the inside of your joints too. After that's done, then you just take some flux and you put that over the end. And then also do flux on the inside of the joint that you're doing. And that way you have flux that's fully surrounding that joint. Then you'll push them in there and you can see that there is a stop. If you look in the end of the tube, you should see the tube that's going in. If you look in the end of the elbow, you should see that end in there, and then you're ready to solder. Now, I did do the first one, like I said, didn't turn out too bad. I put a little bit too much solder on. I heard about a trick where you can, depending on the size that you are soldering, you can bend about that much of the solder. Now, of course, that's gonna also depend on what gauge solder you have, but if you've got a half inch pipe, you bend about a half an inch of solder and it should take about that much to do it. Now, when doing this, you just get your torch. I've just got one of these and we'll open it up. Give it a couple flicks. Once you have the fire going, you're gonna heat up the pipe that is going in just for a couple seconds. Maybe give that 4, 5, 6 seconds. Then you come over here and you start on the elbow where you want the solder to go. The solder does go towards the heat. So now you can see the solder starting to melt and it's gone all the way through. If you look down inside of the pipe, you should also be able to see it there. So that's all it really takes. Just a little bit of flux and then you tap that solder in there and it'll go in. Make sure if you're doing this in a vise that you don't tighten it too much. You just want it to barely pinch and hold it because you will crush that pipe, and copper's so soft it will crush it. And then make sure, obviously, you give this a chance to cool down before you grab onto it. Since you are playing with fire, you probably don't want a messy work area like I have, but you just want to make sure that it's nice and contained here. So that's basically how to solder. Now that I've got that done, if I take this out of the vise, I'm just being careful. You can see on the bottom I've got some drips down here. That's because I just used too much solder. No big deal. Again, I'm going more for function than form, so I don't care about that. Now, a plumber might be like, well, yeah, there's no way you're passing a test doing that kind of shitty work, but again, I'm just going for function, make sure that this is nice and sealed and is going to take the pressures that are gonna be given. Now, when I did do these, I only sanded the joint that I am going to solder, because now that I soldered it, this joint on the end had all kinds of exhaust gas coming out from doing the solder. And now before soldering this to the main pipe, I will need to sand that again too. So no sense in going through and, oh, there it goes. I better get it before it burns through the carpet. There's no sense in going through and sanding everything first, because again, you want those joints to be clean, and after you solder, it might not be so clean. So just do them one at a time as you go, and then you'll be in good shape. Everything was coming along just fine, and I had my T's that were completely connected for the bottom here. And then I realized, well, those ball joints are like $8 a piece. I can actually do away with two of them. So I can get rid of this one and instead of a T there, just put an elbow. And then I can eliminate two of those ball joints and down tubes. So I'll really only have three ball joints at the bottom. And then this way, as the air comes in, and goes up and it's first cooled, any condensation is going to build in that second one. I put the ball joint on the right hand side because as the air is coming down and then going back up, it's going to push any water over down into that trap. So if you put it on this left hand side, any water that's coming down this has to go against the flow of the air, which might push it up and into the next one. So if you put the trap over here to the right, then as the air flows this way, it'll push down. So we're gonna do that, and then that way I can return two of those ball joints and get a little bit money back and make this a little bit cheaper. So we're gonna keep on chugging away here. Basically, I've got some of the joints done, laid out. This is how the air is going to come in. So I've got this T, which is a half inch T, then I got a half inch reducer to this nipple here that the hose will attach to from the regulator, which then goes to the air compressor, and then at the bottom I'll have the ball joint here. So the air is going to come in here, go up, come down. I'll have an elbow, 90 degree elbow, come into a T, and then there'll be a drop there with another ball joint. Then it'll go up again and then down and over to another ball joint. So we'll have three. All right, keep on trucking. Well, here it is, almost done. Basically, all I need to do is solder a couple joints right down here, getting ready to do, and then put the ball joints on the bottom. So we're gonna go ahead and solder those up and get the ball joints on. I'll just zoom in down here so we can get a look. I didn't quite follow my own advice. I know that I said that just do one at a time, but since these are separate enough, I just went ahead and sanded them down and got them prepped and the flux in there, and we're just gonna hit all four joints at once. So here we go. Dryer, and then laying this flat and then propping it up on the bricks. Let me make sure that these are all straight instead of being torqued, so that way when I use those clamps, the pipe clamps, to bolt them to the wall, it'll be nice and flat on the wall. So should be good to go here pretty soon. And then the next step, what I'm going to do is I'll go ahead, after I get the ball joints together, I'm gonna go ahead and run a line over to it and pressurize it. And then I can take a spray bottle with some soapy water and just spray it on the joints themselves, see if there's any bubbles and if there's any leaks that I need to redo before sticking it up on the wall. That's something that'll probably help save some time, especially for anybody who hasn't done soldering before, because if you take all the time, bolt it up to the wall, and then you have a leak, then you gotta take it all down and redo it again. So not a bad idea to just go ahead and connect it all up and give it a couple tests, and maybe even pressurize it and leave it for, you know, like in a couple hours and make sure there's no pressure drop. All right, doing a little pressure test now. As you can see here, I've got my line coming in from my regulator. It goes in here, up and back down through this section, up and back down through here, up, and attaches to my line, which is here. And now, out of there, seems pretty dry. Even though this is laying flat, still probably cooling off the air and maybe capturing some in there. So far so good. I don't hear any leaks. I can open these ball valves to drain from down here. And let's see how noisy that's going to be. Alright, that one works. That one works. That one works. Alright, all three ball valves work. Pressure seems to be holding. So now I'm just going to get some soapy water in a spray bottle, spray it down, look for any bubbles in any of the joints. And now that I disconnected this hose, that should not leak since this is a cheap air gun. I'm going to go ahead and shut off the valve going from the air compressor over to the regulator, which is currently on about 85 pounds. I figured I'd start just a little bit short. And yeah, I'm happy with it. It only took a few hours. Did make a couple mistakes, or not mistakes, but changes along the way. Changing this from five different ball valves down to three. That'll save some money. And then once I get this finished and get some more supplies, I'll be adding the Desiccant dryer right next to it, so it'll take all the heavy moisture out and then hit the Desiccant dryer to really get nice and dry before getting to the tools. So please like and subscribe. Let me know in your comments, or in the comments, if you have any questions or tips or ideas or anything that I could or should have done better. And yeah, let me know how things are going. Thanks. Okie stokers. Got it up on the wall, mounted. Basically, we've got the line coming out of the compressor. I am going to switch this ball valve out to at least a half an inch. Comes over here, goes into the regulator. goes through, max of 90 pounds, comes out of the regulator, comes down here and goes into my dryer. The dryer then has the first vent, goes up and down to the second vent, up and down to the third vent, up to my hose out to my tools. So pretty cool stuff. Excited to see. I did a little paper test and it seems to be working because I don't get any moisture when just shooting the air gun on the paper. Soon I'll be adding up here another piece, and I'm gonna put a Desiccant dryer that goes before the tools up there. So that'll be in the next video. Stay tuned. Don't forget to like and subscribe. Thanks for watching.